Dear colleagues, my name is Eva Wurpka. I am heading the SmartLook Ophthalmic Center of Aarau, that is in Switzerland, and I am going to present on my experience with the new 24-2C pattern and the application of glaucoma workplace in general. Being asked how we work under the impression of the current pandemic, following is what we do. We keep the doors and windows open to avoid anybody touching handles and to have an active exchange. Of course, patients and personnel were wearing masks, keep distance, and there are no handshakes anymore. We are not using brief shields, as I don't see how they could contribute to more safety when all our measures are carefully followed. But we need to be careful that wearing masks are an additional source of artifacts, namely that we get condensate on the lenses of our diagnostic devices. This can lead to erroneous visual field results if not recognized and avoided. But our main subject to care for our patient has not changed much with the pandemic. And I am happy to contribute to an active exchange among peers and present some cases from our center today. Let us start with this 79-year-old woman. On both eyes, she has a pseudophakia, and on the right eye, a Xen implant in August 2017. Both eyes have a glaucoma chronicum simplex. The IOP is between 17 and 20. There is no therapy since she had surgery, and the question is, does she need therapy again? I have forum automatically creating combined reports. This gives me a quick way of assessing the status of a person's vision. When I looked at this patient, she just received her first 24-2C test after previously being examined with the 32 CETA standard. Already in the first visual field of the right eye from 2014, the patient had developed a significant nasal step, so this is no surprise. The ganglion cell analysis indicates the deviation from the norm in the macular area, but only the 24-2C I can now see that the macular area is also functionally affected. The question is how much? And what might be a nasal step in the left eye comes as a surprise. We will look into this one too. So my next step will be to assess the status for the right eye completely to check how profound the deviation in the macular area are. But while staying on the screen, let us also look at the left eye. It does not show any deviation in the OCT result, but it does show a nasal step in the visual field. And I need to know if now the left eye is also getting worse or if we just caught an artifact. With the glaucoma workplace, I can now access the information either via the visual field GPA or via the visual field browser. If I this was my patient first visual field, the latter might be the best option, so let us open the visual field browser. Let us look at the right eye first. The paracentral deviation are as profound as 12 dB. Since this is a severe deviation from the norm and it was the first time the patient received a 24-2C, I decided to call her in for a repetition of the 24-2C. Allowing me first confirm the findings, second, set a new baseline, and third, start observing any functional changes in this area. When you have a defect of 12 dB, you may also start wondering what the reproducibility is. The threshold at this most affected test location is 22 dB. According to publication of Gardiner and Wall, thresholds below 20 dB are not reliable due to their low reproducibility. The practical meaning of this is that with just some more worsening, perception of stimuli in this spot may be one time there, one time gone, and that means not reliable. Of course, we always expect some variability in a visual field result. Upon her return, the lady was pretty excited and made more mistakes than usual. The nasal step in the left eye disappeared completely. But we will keep an eye on this in the future. More interesting is our finding upon her repetition of the right eye. While some defects appear shallower, there is one relative defect that now has turned in an almost absolute defect. Looks like the 24 tooth C test locations are spot on where we, the neuralgic points are. Next, I like to see the OCT raw data and the progression information. So let's go to the structure function GPA. Structure function GPA always first displays the right eye's information, but now I specifically need to see the left eye. We see that besides a hint on possible decrease in the RNFL analysis, there are little to no signs about an abnormality. Let us therefore look at the raw data. There are two things that caught my eye, knowing that the potential nasal step is inferior. Accordingly, you would look for RNFL changes superiorly, and you see that the superior branch is thinner than the inferior branch. And also, it looks like it got thinner over time. I therefore expect a trend, and I can specifically check the superior RNFL trend, which I am going to do now. For the relevant measurements on the optic nerve and the macular area, you can choose to calculate the trend either globally or for one hemisphere only. I am selecting the average superior RNFL thickness therefore. The trend line has a yellow dot indicated possible decrease at the second last scan and a red dot indicated likely decrease at the most recent scan. But let us enlarge it to see some more. The trend is larger than the variability, almost double, so it appears a significant trend. The trend of minus 1.5 microns per year is much more than the minus 0.25 microns per year derived from the normal aging according to the Cyrus normal value study. More conservative users may subtract 0.5 microns per year to compensate for aging. The trend and the asymmetry of the RNFL thickness to me are confirmation of the relevance of the nasal step we have found in the visual field. The left eye shows initial glaucomatose changes, but we looked at change between 2014 and today. What is the progression under the current regimen? To find out, we have to change the baseline. I will show in the analysis of the right eye how to change the baseline for the OCT scans. Here I just present the results to you. We still get a possible decrease in the progression map and a range of change of minus 1.9 plus minus 2.0 microns per year. The variability is high, but most likely the trend continues. Thus, we should stay vigilant. Just as a side note, and for those of you with eagle eyes, deviations from the norm are only displayed as soon as they fall under the fifth percentile of normality. Obviously, in the left eyes, that is not the case. But if you look at the ganglion cell layer thickness more closely and enlarge it furthermore, you recognize the asymmetry and the subtle nasal step that extend even to the macula. Maybe a kind of pattern deviation analysis for the OCT might be a good idea. On the other hand, we really have to deal with a lot of information already. Back to the right eye of my patient. The red areas already tell me that there has been quite some progression, but the patient's latest RNFL scan is not visible. I am opening the OCT selection to learn more. The signal strength is 5 only, and all signal strengths below 6 is not automatically included in the progression analysis. The scan preview does not look too bad, so I am including it. The most obvious change is in the progression maps, but also in the RNFA thickness profile. Let us take a closer look. Baselines. The black line and the dashed black line should always be very similar. If they differ a lot, then there were significant changes and or there were segmentation errors in one or the other baseline scans. Either way, you should then change the baseline selection. Let us concentrate on the area that indicates changes. The older baseline is the profile on the top. The labeling is incorrect and, as I understand, will be fixed soon. Thus, there is still a significant change between the second baseline and the most recent scan, the blue line. So let us change the OCT selection. First, you remove the tags from the original baseline and you remove the follow-up exam that are prior to your new baseline. Then you select the new baselines and the follow-up exams. Try to exclude cases where floaters and subheights might affect the RNFL segmentation. The RNFL profile is derived along the red 3.46 mm diameter ring, which unfortunately is not displayed in this preview here. While changing the selection for the RNFL, makes sense to change the selection for the G ganglion cell layer and the IPL layer analysis at the same time. I have included some scans with signal strength 5 for the follow-up. You should be careful to make sure that the segmentation in these scans was okay. Click on Apply. We identify an area of change in the ganglion cell analysis and we identify a significant rate of changes. Let us look a bit closer. This confirms that the change is recent and or ongoing. The rate of change for the complete ganglion cell layer is minus 1.2 plus minus 0.8 microns per year. For the superior hemifeld, it is minus 1.7 plus minus 1.5 microns per year and 0.6 plus minus 0.2 microns per year in the inferior hemifeld. These are many numbers, but they help us to conclude that the change is in the superior retina only and that they correspond with the 24-2C. Just not to forget and to make this a very complete case. We should never forget the status of the patient. For this, we should take a look at the deviation from the norm and the layer thickness. Progression is only possible in areas where significant ganglion cell and nerve and fiber are left. And the layer thickness. Progression is only possible in areas where sufficient ganglion cell and nerve fibers are left. Hence, in more advanced disease, the visual field gains more and more importance. But as has been shown in this case, we really need both. To summarize, right eye. The paracentral areas of the right eye is functionally affected, which I learned thanks to the 24-2C, and the progression is ongoing, which was displayed by the ganglion cell progression map. The trend analysis shows more trend than variability plus aging. The right eye of the patient is still progressing. Left eye. The visual field showed a distinct nasal step that was gone when she repeated the test. The structural data is still in the normal range. RNFL thickness shows early and slow progression corresponding with an early nasal step. At this rate of change, I am not concerned about the future vision of my patient, but I have to monitor her closely, especially in the paracentral area. Case number two. It's a woman, 71 years old. Both eyes have a cataract and a glaucoma chronicum simplex. The therapy is with Simbrinza. And the IOP varies about 15 to 21 on the right side, 15 to 19 on the left side. This case, I like to show you to not forget about the periphery. Let us start again with the structure function report with this patient. She is kind of atypical, but her optic nerve looks suspicious and she has some isolated peripheral spots. An outside normal limits, GHT in the right eye and small areas outside the norm in RNFL maps in both eyes. Definitely nothing to worry about in the visual field, right? So let us look at the structure. Wow, that was pretty unexpected. This is some serious RNFL progression. But how it is possible that the patient lost a rough 40 microns of RNFL thickness without showing on the deviation map? Because the RNFL thickness in the inferior optic nerve is still way above the fifth percentile of normality. Deviation from norm is not really a sensitive measure. Progression usually precedes a deviation from the norm. While this is true for both visual field and OCT, it is just much more striking in OCT. Thus, we have confirmed progression in the right eye in the inferior RNFL. We have a deviation from the norm in the superior RNFL, and we had some inferior visual field defects in the previous examination, which could correspond to the RNFL deviation. Next step, we need to know if the change is current or historic, and we should get a better idea how it affects the visual field. Let us first change the baseline. After changing the baseline, there seems much less progression. The rates of change are below 1 microns per year, and the second baseline of the RNFL scan is basically the same as the current RNFL layer thickness. This patient's right eye appears stable since the end of 2017. Let us look at the left eye. Let us see how tricky it is if we only look for hints on progression. Definitely, we see progression in the RNFL map, the blue arrow. But the current RNFL map indicates that we have deviation from the norm that is in the different area that the progression we found. So let me quickly show you the status, the deviation from the norm. This is the most profound structure defect, and we may expect to see a correspondence in the visual field. This is something we should see in the inferior visual field, but the current visual field hardly shows any defects. So let us look back in time. The previous visual field was the 32, and now we recognize an affected area that, with the 21 degree inferior eccentricity of the 24-2 and 24-2C, can easily be overlooked. For the patients, this is a relevant area. It may cause the patients to stumble if she or he has scotoma in this area. Hence, I would wish to see a 32C type test that allows me at some compromise 30 to 60 seconds more test time to include the peripheral test location again. But let us close the case for now. Is the patient stable? We still identify a rather diffuse progression which cannot exactly be identified on the progression maps. But the inferior RNFL thickness change is 4.4 microns per year, which despite a large confidence interval is a quick change that needs close follow-up. To conclude, right eye, the progression disappeared once we adjust the baseline to 2017. The eye is stable. The left eye, we have an established wedged defect that projects to the inferior visual field and takes a 32 to make it extend better visible. The RNFL points to a rapid ongoing progression in the inferior optic nerve. So we present one more case. It is a 64-year-old man, a more advanced case. In the history, on both eye, myopia per magna, he got a refractive IOL on his own lens. Then an increase of IOP followed in 2015. And then he got a CPC and a canaloplasty because he doesn't tolerate any eye drops. Now, current therapy is ADSOPT on both eyes, Safluton both eyes, and the PRG on the right eye has normalized since reintroduction of therapy. The left PRG is always normal. The OCT is all red, myopia per magna, and the visual field, thanks to the 24-2C, tells us that the macular area is involved more in the left eye as compared to the right eye. So we need to know progression and we need to understand in how much the macular area is affected. Our visual fields appear pretty stable, but we should not forget that progression analysis is only performed on the mutual test location that exists prior to the 24-2C. Thus we should know how profound the central defects in the left eye are. Now we see that the paracentral defects are partially very profound, down to minus 24 decibel. These are defects that can become absolute scotoma soon. To perform progression analysis in the new 24-2C locations, it requires 3 fields for the triangle plot and 5 fields for calculating the trend rate of progression. Until then, we have to observe these defects manually. Let us switch to structure function progression analysis. The progression graphs of the right eye look the same for the quite some time. We need to change the baseline to know what is happening more recently. Looks like one of our new baselines has a segmentation error, so we need to remove it. And also other scan seems to be an outlier for the same reason. Not much going on in the right eye. You may think the RNFL thickness is going further down at 1.8 micron per year. Let us switch to the left eye and change the baseline. No obvious change for progression is in the left eye. The devil is again in the details. The ganglion cell rates of change indicates that the center is getting worse on an already low level thickness. To conclude, right eye, this eye is losing RNFL thickness despite otherwise giving a stable impression. Left eye, we saw that the macula is affected seriously from the visual field perspective thanks to the new test location of the 24-2C. This cannot be overlooked. And the ganglion cell analysis shows an ongoing worsening. As a next step, we consider a transscleral cyclophotocoagulation before any larger intervention. Our final case for today is a 75-year-old woman, pseudophakia on both eyes, post-cataract surgery is the IOP normal. Since end of July, she gets COSOPT, and in begin of August, we make also an SLT. And the question is, does PERC contribute to the information positive or negative? We have the paracentral area affected in the left eye, not in the right eye. And in this case, we also want to ask ourselves if the PRG helps us in our conclusions. But let's first look at the visual field. We have some history here. We need to change the baseline. The worsening in the left eye could be from previous years. Looking at the left eye with a more recent baseline, we see no global trend, but quite some areas that are getting worse. And let us not forget to keep an eye on the new 24-2C test locations. Currently, we still have to evaluate changes by comparing pattern deviation from visit to visit. Left eye. The triangle plot shows various test locations that get worse in the visual field. The superior RNFL has a rapid progression of minus 4.5 micron per year. There is also diffuse ganglion cell layer loss of approximately 1 micron per year. We just mentioned this to complete the picture. Now we switch to the right eye. So, no clear progression appears visible. The ganglion cell layer thickness is probably decreasing above normal aging with 1 micron per year. We therefore want to keep a close look at the paracentral location at the future visits. Now to the PRGs. The January PRGs signal ratios correspond with our overall assessment. The July PRG has a terrible signal to noise ratio and artifacts, and we cannot really trust it. We repeated this measurement. I would expect the right eye to be in the green range, which is not. The left has improved somewhat, which is according to my expectations. We repeated the measurement. The August PRG signal to noise ratios are good and no artifacts appeared. I would expect the right to be in the green range, which it is not. The left eye has improved somewhat, which is according to my expectations that the treatment brought some relief. In the right eye, maybe due to dry eyes and other factors contributed to the variable results. Ratio 0.75 to 0.15 to 0.64. But what it tells us is that there might be more going on in the right eye than we can see with the OCT and the visual field yet. We have to keep an eye on the macular area of the right eye. There may be very early functional alterations. To conclude, right eye, we just may have caught the earliest signs of worsening and try to keep it on a normal level. The PRG gives us more reasons to be suspicious. Left eye, we have to keep a close eye. The superior RNFL shows rapid decrease and the macular area keeps going down. With respect to the meaning of PRG, it appears to provide additional information on the macular status, but it is sensitive to visus and dry eyes. Our summary, we don't want to miss the 24-2C anymore. We have quite some patients with functional affected paracentral areas, and it is important to identify those and quantify their defects in routine operation. When structure and function don't match, try to get an explanation, especially in cases with significant loss on either structure or function. This might mean running a 32 on a patient. Changing baselines to reflect surgery and other clinical events is important. And don't forget to assess progression rates in light of changes due to normal aging.